the main move in the position is knight to e4. After e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, d4, ed, bishop c4, knight f6, e5, d5, bishop b5, and knight d7, you can hardly ever see in your game. Knight e4 is the main continuation. And here we play knight takes d4, and black has only two moves they can consider here. They can play bishop c5 or bishop d7. Now let's look at those moves. Let's look at bishop d7 first. Bishop d7 is the most logical and most expected move. Well, now our pawn on e5 is hanging, so we have to play bishop takes c6, pawn takes c6, and we castle. Here is the position of whole opening. Black has two bishops, and black has potentials moving the central pawns. These double pawns is not necessarily bad for black, maybe real good. Here black has three different ways they can play this position. They can go bishop e7, not play bishop c5, because they may want to play bishop e7 to later activate pawns, c and d pawns. Or they may play bishop e5, or they may play c5 right away, try to move these pawns immediately. Okay, again, there is no order in which we have to look at this continuation. Well, let's look with c5 moves. Let's look what we're gonna do on c5. On c5 move I recommend is knight to b3. After knight b3, d5 pawn is hanging, and let's see what black can do. Black can go c4, but c4 is not very good because queen takes d5, attacking the knight on e4. So here, bishop b5, but then we go rook e1, and now black has to continue development. They cannot keep pushing pawn because the knight goes to d4, attacking the bishop. So if they play bishop e7, strangely enough, this move bad, because we're gonna go f3, and black is in a lot of trouble, because after knight g5, we can simply take on g5, bishop takes g5, and knight takes c5. We just won a very important pawn, part of black's chain that would want to move, and then we're gonna go knight c3. We have extra pawn and a better position. So this variation is clearly not acceptable for black. So here black has difficulties finding useful move. Well, if they go bishop c6, or if they never play bishop b5 but go bishop c6 right away, supporting the center, we go f3, and after knight g5, f4, and after knight e4, knight c3. Well, and when black takes on c3, we take back, is very, very bad for black, because when they try to develop, we're gonna go f5, or even bishop e3, attacking c5 pawn, and when black goes c4, then knight d4, followed by f5 and queen g4, black is nearly lost here. So what else can they do? They can go, besides c5, bishop to e7, and bishop to c5. Well, they have to develop pieces. Well, let's start with bishop e7. On bishop e7, we have basically in this position, you know, when you play this position, you have to know one thing. You have to be convinced to do one out of two things. Then you play this opening correctly. You either get direct attack on opponent's king or get total blockade of dark squares. And, well, I explain you a little down the road what I mean by blockade of the dark squares. So, blockade on dark squares will happen in the bishop c5 case. Now we look at bishop e7. So what we want to do, since bishop e7 kind of congesting black's background pieces. So we go f3. What we want to do, we want to activate f pawn. So we don't go f4 because we're going to win tempo if we go f3 first. Knight g5, knight c5, knight g5, for example, f4, knight e4. Now, notice if he goes knight e6, you will go f5. He has no time to pin you, so when black takes on d4, queen takes d4, you see the position is very dangerous for black. White is threatening to completely open black's king position. So, knight should go back to e4. And b1 here. So now what we do is we play knight to c3. Not knight d2, knight c3. And when black takes on c3, we take back with a pawn. We don't mind double pawns. Double pawns are very, very good here. Because when black castles and we go f5, you have to notice here that if black goes c5, we go knight to b3, not knight. We cannot go knight f3 because we lose the f5 pawn. And it's interesting, why are we going knight b3 and not knight e2? We go knight b3, c4, knight d4, c5, and now knight e2. It looks like white made some kind of a time-wasting moves. No, there is a reason why we should go knight b3. And here it is. When we go knight e2, pinning black to play bishop b5 and pinning the knight and later on taking the knight, maybe that will release the pressure. So we want to go knight to b3. Now if black goes bishop b5, we can go rook f3 or rook e1, and then we go bishop e3, putting pressure on c5 pawn and forcing black to go c4 and blocking their own bishop. So once we go knight b3, and if black goes c4, knight d4 back, and when they go c5, we go knight e2. It's a beautiful square for knight. As long as black cannot play bishop b5, and in this case, take that knight. So now knight on e2 stands real well, because it has good potentials. After bishop c6, we could go bishop e3, stop d4, or go knight g3, followed by knight h5, and queen g4. Knight is very active player on kingside attack. This is very, very powerful position for white. So again, after bishop e7, we go f3. Here is the position. f3. Doesn't change anything if black plays bishop knight c5, because we're going to go f4 then. And if black castles, we go f5. which should transpose to the same position, and if knight e6, also f5. And of knight e4 again, we go knight c3, that gives us very, very strong position. Now let's look at bishop c5 move, which is the main move here, and I think is the strongest move in this position. We go f3, knight goes to g5, and we go f4, giving black again two options to play knight e4 or knight e6. On knight e4 we play bishop e3, and on knight e6 we play pawn c3. And here is why. On knight e6 we go pawn c3 because we want to gain tempo on f5, and if he takes our knight, we want to take with a pawn to gain tempo on attacking bishop. So after knight e6 and c3, suppose black castles, we go f5, knight cd, and after bishop b6, simply developing quickly knight c3, don't push the king, the e and f pawns yet. We have to complete development, bring the pieces. Pawns on e5 and f5 are very powerful, and we don't have to push them right away. So, for example, on move like rook e8, be careful, don't blunder rook takes e5 move. On something like rook to e8, it's useful to move the king out of the way, out of the pin. That eliminates rook takes e5 threat, and just is good to stay out of away from bishop from diagonal, from a7 g1 diagonal. So this position is very promising for white also, but that's in case in this position after bishop c5 we played f3, knight g5, and f4, but main move is knight e4, of course. Then we go bishop e3, and next thing we want to do, no matter what he plays, we want to exchange e4 knight for our b1 knight. But we have to be very, very careful the way we do that. If black castles, we must play knight d2, and if black plays bishop b6, we must play knight c3. And make sure you do it correctly, or you're gonna have position in both cases in a castle on bishop b6. If you don't play correct knight move, you may get bad position. And here is why. If black castles in this position, you see they cannot push c5 yet on the next move anyway. So what white wants to do, as I mentioned before, you have to get either kingside attack or dark square blockade. We're playing for dark square blockade. We go knight d2, knight takes d2 or f5. It does not make any difference. Knight takes d2, queen takes d2. And now when black goes bishop b6, trying to activate the c-pawn, we go knight b3, and mission accomplished. We just blocked c5 and d4 squares, dark squares. We're going to go knight c5, queen c3, and pawn b4. It's a total blockade position. Black center is blocked, and white has much better position. We're gonna analyze this little further, but now before we go on with this variation, I want to show you what's the difference when if he plays bishop b6 first, knight d2 is a bad move now. And here is why. Because we cannot make the blockade, because d2, queen takes d2, pawn c5, knight b3, pawn d4, bishop f2, bishop c6, followed by queen d5, black has very powerful position. But we're not going to let them do that. Okay, if black plays bishop e3 first, we change the plan. Then we go knight to c3. Now, if they take on c3, they do the same thing. Because we're going to take back with a pawn, and after c5, we go knight b3. And as you see now, we have a pawn on c3, and d4 cannot be played. So black is in a lot of trouble. They have c and d pawn hanging. And if bishop comes to b5, simply rook f2, or even rook e1, whichever you want. So, and now c pawn is hanging, that is very difficult to defend. And after c4, we can go either knight d4 followed by f5, or maybe c5 followed by queen d4 and f5. In both cases, black has a very difficult game. So again, here is the position where black has two moves. They can castle. Bishop is on e3. Then we play knight d2. And they can go bishop to b6. Then we go knight d3. And don't you make mistake about it. That's the exactly how it must be played. Now, if knight takes on c3, we take back, and we have the stopper pawn on c3 that does not allow black's pawns to advance further. So this is the way this should be played. Now let's go on and continue the analysis with blockade position. How knight takes d2, queen takes d2, bishop b6, knight b3, queen to e7, and we play queen to c3. Now suppose black goes f6. Now we can go knight c5. Well, I don't like to put bishop on c5 because bishop is pinned and black does not have to take on c5. So we put knight c5, pawn takes e5, pawn takes e5. Now you see that black's are totally blocked. We have serious positional advantage. Now if rook goes to e8, we will go simply b4. Because you see our knight is protect just enough number of times with queen and bishop, but we want to release the queen and use queen for kingside play, and we have to start playing on kingside. So we're going to go b4, and there is a trap. Remember, black cannot take on e5 because black, there is a very powerful shot that wins immediately here. Rook f8 check. And no matter which way black takes the rook, they're going to lose the queen. On king takes f8, knight takes d7 check and a fork. And on rook takes f8, simply queen takes e5. So this cannot be done. And if black plays bishop takes c5, which they will have to do sooner, because we're going to go a4 and a5, bishop will have to take this knight. It's just a matter of time. We play bishop takes c5. Again, pawn cannot be taken because of rook f8 check that wins the queen. And if queen moves to e6 somewhere, then white plays rook f3, followed by rook f1, doubling rook on f file. opposite color bishops always make attack stronger. Then we can go rook g3, rook f6. Remember, here, because of either rook f8 check or bishop d4, having very powerful, very strong pressure on g7 pawn, so you don't have to directly protect your e5 pawn. Well, in some cases, for example, the queen goes to g6, you may even be happy to give this pawn up, to give it away. Also, on rook takes e6, now you may go rook g3, followed by bishop d4. This may be very dangerous for black, and it is dangerous. So this is the way to play the blockade position. And there are several different varieties where we will get these blockade positions. So in this position, after white's fifth move e5, besides the main move d5, black has two other continuations. One of them is knight to e4, and the other one is knight to g4. Knight to e4, there are a couple of ways we can play. We can simply castle, and maybe we don't get much of an advantage after d6 or black's d5. That's something you can easily look in the any theoretical book, any book about the openings. But what I recommend in this position to play is bishop to d5, after we almost forced to play knight c5, and we castle. So what we want to do is simply get our pawn back with white. And only reason black would play knight e4 is to play knight e6 now and try to maintain the extra pawn. Let's see what's going to happen. After knight to e6, we play rook to e1. Black plays bishop to e7. And you see, we cannot get our pawn back by taking on c6 and knight on e6, because in both cases, black would recapture with a d-pawn, and we are not going to get our pawn back. So what we want to do here, we want to play knight to d2, castle, knight to b3. Now white is ready to capture the pawn on d4 with the knight and have a little space advantage and have a little better. So move for black is d6, then we go bishop takes c6, pawn takes c6, and knight b takes to d4. This position is definitely better for white, and here is why. It's not good for black to take pawn on e5, because after knight takes c6, they are in very bad shape, because queen hangs and pawn hangs on e5, and bishop on e7 is also in danger. For example, one, white takes in between move, plays in between move knight takes e7 check, winning a bishop. So d takes c is definitely not a good move. The choice that black has is to play knight takes d4, knight takes d4, and bishop d7, or maybe bishop d7 right away. On bishop d7 right away, we can simply play knight f5. You can tell we have certain pressure on black's center, and we have development, and we can always get rid of black's dark square bishop, and we're going to have some advantage. And if black plays knight takes d4, we go knight takes d4, and again d takes c is a bad move, because knight takes c6 wins at least a pawn. Queen takes d1 loses again to knight takes e7 check, and black is experiencing serious problems in this position. So in this position, black must play something like bishop d7, and we can go either bishop f4, and we are better developed and our piece is more active, and we have a little bit of an advantage, or maybe even e takes d, and after c takes d, we can play bishop f4, and maybe even queen f3, attacking c6 pawn, followed by bishop f4. White has slight advantage. So that's pretty much all you have to know if what to do if black plays knight e4 move on move 5 after e5, knight to e4. So we go bishop d5, and after knight c5 we castle, and on knight e6 we go rook e1. So that briefly covers the knight e4 continuation. Now let's go to the other move, which is knight to g4. Now after knight g4, it's difficult, and very difficult I would say, for white to get an advantage, but white definitely has, in all variations, comfortable position. So we have to play queen e2. And now why queen e2? Why do we have to protect the e5 pawn by playing queen e2? Why not castling? Or why not bishop to f4? Now, bishop to f4 we don't want to play because black is going to go d6. And they are free. Well, we have to take, and black comfortably concludes development. We don't want to do this, and we don't want to castle for the same reason, because black goes d6, and if we take, black is going to play bishop takes d6. So what white has to do here, white has to interfere with d6 move. So white goes queen to e2. And now, if black simply continues development, then we can go after bishop e7, we can go simply h3, and knight to go to h6, and then we damage black's kingside pawn structure. So what is the best move in this position for black is to queen e7. And now we go bishop f4. And here, black must play one of two moves, f6 or d6. And in both cases, position simplifies, and I would say in both cases, white has a little advantage. Look at this continuation. d6, pawn takes d6. Well, black, of course, can retake with the c-pawn, but I think it's better if black takes the queen on e2, bishop takes e2, and bishop takes d6. Now, this position is slightly better for white, because white plays bishop takes d6, pawn takes d6, and now it's important we don't have to rush to get our d4 pawn back. So we're gonna go knight 3, and now white wants to play knight to b5, attacking both d pawns, or maybe knight to c4 in case black plays a6, then we can go knight c4, attacking d6 pawn and threatening knight b6. And also, if black plays something like knight e5, maybe we can castle long and put more pressure on d4 pawn and eventually get it back. So this position is slightly better. Black cannot keep pawn on d4 under no circumstances. Knight b5, knight c4, and castling, projected castling for white king to queen side, and maybe even queen side if knight does not move from g4. So white has some advantage and they have no problems getting their pawn back. Now we have to cover also f6 continuation. It does not represent any danger or any problem for white, but as I mentioned, it's not that easy to get serious advantage in this position. Now, when black plays f6, we have to take on f6, and here black has three moves. They can capture back with a knight, they can capture back with a pawn, or they can capture our queen first. In all three cases, what is going to happen is white will definitely get the d4 pawn back. White, and they will have at least equal position. I think they will have some slight advantage. Well, let's look at g takes f. What we have to do, there is some possibility of playing bishop takes c7, and black does not win white's bishop. White goes bishop b5, but this is not safe for white. And I was recommending this in my previous publications, in my previous DVDs. Well, now I came to the conclusion that it's a lot easier for white, a lot safer to play knight d2 with a simple idea of going knight b3 and getting the d4 pawn. No matter what black does, they cannot effectively interfere with it. Now on queen takes e2, we go bishop takes e2. Now suppose black is stubborn and they want to keep an extra pawn. Bishop c5, knight to b3. Now on bishop b6, well, here is the extra pawn on d4. We're gonna get it eventually. We could go bishop b5, get it back, or we could go even h3 and after knight e5, castling long. Eventually we're gonna get this pawn back, and knight takes f3, bishop takes f3. Now, for now, black does keep an extra pawn, but obviously white is gonna have no problem getting it back after bishop takes c6 and knight takes d4. This is one option, or white can simply play rook h2 e1 and continue direct attack on black's king. It's not recommended in that position for black to try to hold on to an extra pawn. White gets a pawn back and they will have at least comfortable position. Now let's go back and again summarize what we just went through. What we went through was e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6. We go d4, and after ed we go bishop c4. And now on main move knight f6, white goes e5, and there are three moves: d5, knight e4, and knight g4. We covered them all, and we came to conclusion white is throughout whole opening, they are between some advantage and big advantage and slightly better position. So that means I will give I would recommend to play very frequently. The other thing we didn't cover, only thing we didn't cover here, is what happens if black plays bishop c5? Now, if black plays bishop c5, now we get different opening.
This is Grandmaster Damian Lemos here for onlinechesslessons.net. First of all, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you would like to receive more free chess videos from us, you can just click the subscribe button below. I would also highly recommend signing up for my free mail course, The 10 Grandmaster Secrets to Dominate Chess. During this exclusive course from onlinechesslessons.net, I'll share with you my own Grandmaster shortcuts to effective attacking, defending, and growth hacks to improving your chess without complicated books or memorization. So sign up by clicking the sidebar on the right, and I know you won't be disappointed. Once more, this is Damien for onlinechesslessons.net, and I'll see you in my videos. Thank you.